Hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and a very good morning to you all. So guys, a very warm welcome to the another session of RBI 24/7. So as most of you would be knowing that in these sessions, we discuss a set of 5 questions and if you are preparing for competitive exams, that can be of use to you. So let's not waste any time and move straight away to the session. But before doing that, guys, I would like to ask you to subscribe to our channel. So for those of you who are watching this video for the very first time, do not forget to hit the subscribe button and you can also press this bell icon. It will help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up. You can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. So guys, are you ready for question number 1? So moving ahead to question number 1. Okay, so this question says, following are some statements about emerging markets, select the correct statement. So 3 statements about emerging markets and you have to select the correct one right? Moving ahead to the solution, correct option for this question is option A. Option A means only one is correct and rest 2 statements are incorrect, right? So guys, first of all, we have to understand that what are these emerging markets and how do they differ from other countries. So in simple term, emerging markets refers to those, so this term emerging markets, it refers to those countries which have a huge potential for growth. Basically, they have not attained their full potential, they have not become developed, but they still have a lot of potential. See, any advanced country, let's talk about Western countries like Germany or USA, UK. So they do not have much potential for growth. Why is it so? Because they have already seen a lot of growth in past. That is why currently they do not have much scope for growth. But if we talk about countries like India or Russia or Brazil, these are the countries where a middle class section is growing and that section is demanding lot of goods and services, right? So whenever income levels of a country increase, obviously the residents are going to be demanding a lot of goods and services, right? So if we talk about India and we talk about the time of 20 years earlier, at that time there were not so many gadgets, there were not new phones coming every year, right? So no one wanted a new phone every year and there were not so many gadgets. So basically, as with advancement of technology, times have changed and there is a lot of there is an extensive range of goods and services which is available to consumers, and these consumers, since their income levels are growing, right? So in past 20 years, India has seen a lot of development with children, with youth getting jobs in multinational companies, going abroad. So once going abroad was considered as a luxury, but now it has become a normal thing for people. Anyone who gets a job at good MNC has chances to go to foreign countries or settle there, right? So basically, India has seen a lot of development. So that is what I'm talking about, the scope for development, the potential for development that is present in emerging markets. That is why these emerging markets have huge potential for growth as compared to the advanced markets, right? So this huge growth potential makes them an attraction for investors. Foreign investors, they want to invest in such markets because they are going to get a huge rate of return that they might not get in advanced countries, right? So that is why talking about statements, first statement that says emerging markets refers to fund. So here we are talking about emerging market fund, basically a mutual fund or an investment fund that invests into assets of emerging countries. So they can be real estate, they can be shares and stocks or other securities based in the emerging markets, right? So they can be a lot of assets. So majority of its assets in securities from countries with economies that are considered to be emerging or growing or developing. They are attractive to fixed income investors. Know that they are not attractive to fixed income investors. Because see, I told you that they have huge potential for growth. That means they are going to provide investors
with high return. But remember the risk return trade-off. If there is going to be high return, there is obviously going to be high risk, because obviously emerging markets, they are vulnerable to more risks, be it any systematic risk like this pandemic COVID-19 that we have been facing, or be it any currency shock, currency manipulation. So emerging markets are more vulnerable to them. So since they are high risk markets, they provide high return and they are attractive to investors who are having good risk appetite, rather than someone who looks for fixed income. So not attractive to fixed income investors. These countries offer low potential return with low risk? No. High potential return with high risk. That is why only first statement is correct and second and third are not correct. So I hope this question is clear to you. Here we can see some more information. I think we have discussed most of it briefly. Let's just take a run through. Okay. Infrastructures and economies of emerging markets nations vary broadly across the world, right? So they can be any African countries, or they can be Asian countries, Southeast Asian countries, which are growing at a very fast pace. So all of them have different natures, have different demographics. That is why the analysis has to be based on the country specific factors. High growth phase with rapidly expanding, improving market environments. In developed countries, they do not have much scope for development, improvement. Experience significant growth from middle class consumers. As I told you, as I gave you the example of youth, which is getting, if they get good jobs, they demand more services, leading to more development. They drive increased demand. So can be a mutual fund or an ETF that invests in securities of different asset classes belonging to emerging markets. Most common places: India, China, Russia and Brazil. So these funds, they offer a range of options across the risk spectrum. So there is always risk involved in high return assets. These are certain risks that are concerned, be it liquidity risk, political risk, inflation risk and others. Right? So moving ahead to next question for today. Here is question number 2. This question says that our service delivery operations typically in low cost geographies, which are owned and operated by the same company receiving the service, right? So moving ahead to the solution, correct option for this question is option C. Option C means global in-house centers, right? Guys, basically the name in itself tells you something that has a global appeal. That means belonging to different countries, in-house, something which is not external but on the internal side, and centers. So what is GIC? We call them GIC in short, global in-house centers. See, there are many companies, and companies have a variety of operations. They can be accountancy, they can be raising finance, they can be marketing operations, they can be costing, right? So they have a lot of operations. Now, in order to specialize in these operations and improve the efficiency, these companies, especially the big companies like Amazon, Apple, these companies, they try to establish different departments to carry out a particular set of tasks. So if they have a marketing department and let's say they have a costing department, then they have production, in that also they have different departments. So where they establish different centers, basically another company or another establishment which is going to provide them with a certain set of services. But the catch here is that these are not outsourced. See, let's say we are talking about Amazon, and Amazon needs to manage its retail payments, right? Whatever payments that we are making it. So if you order anything through Amazon, and then you are making a payment using Amazon Pay or Google Pay, so they have to maintain that digital infrastructure so that they can maintain the they can receive your payments. So for that they need a tech department. So they are going to establish a new company for this, right? But the catch here is they are not outsourcing, because this company is certainly belonging to Amazon, right? Or the company who is receiving the services of this company. Now, why are they called global? Because see, if Amazon is based in US, it is not necessary that it is going to base this particular establishment, this particular service providing entity in the same country. So it might be possible that these services are better available in India. So they might establish this entity in India, right? See, this is different from BPO culture or business processes outsourcing, because in BPO, the operations are outsourced to a third party which is doing similar type of jobs for many companies. But here, this entity, this is not an external entity but an in-house entity, right, belonging to this particular company. So they are trying to concentrate the operations rather than scatter them to different entities, but they are trying to base these entities into those countries or those geographies where it is cost effective to maintain them, or where it is cheaper and more efficient to carry out their operations, right? So this is basically a GIC, Global In-House Center. Service delivery operations, typically in low cost geographies like India or other Asian economies, owned and operated by the same company receiving the services, right? So I hope you are clear with the difference between GIC and BPOs. These are in-house, BPOs are third party. Okay. Now, why are we talking about GICs? Because it is now being expected that a lot of GICs are going to be opened in India in this coming year, right? See, because India is growing very fast and we are building the tech infrastructure at a very fast speed. Obviously, there are some loopholes that need to be managed. There are some gaps that need to be filled. But our regulators are taking many steps to make this infrastructure available so that these companies can set up these type of operations in India, and it is cost effective for them to maintain their operations in India, right? Because if they settle these operations in countries like India, then we are going to get employment out of it. Our public is going to get employment, our government is going to get taxes. So obviously it is beneficial if we receive such sort of investments. But for that, we have to provide these foreign companies with a business friendly environment and a conducive environment so that they can carry out their operations at low cost, right? Okay. So GIC is expected to be set up in India, look to build by companies who look to build futuristic technologies capabilities, easily done outside of the geographic boundaries of their head offices, right? So it is not a very new concept. It has been around since 1990s, right? They were also known as global capability centers or captives. They emerged in 1990s as offshore units of large multinationals like American Express or Citigroup, right? So in India, the fields which are expected to see growth in this area are banking, financial services, right? Because of the digital transformation. See, we have talked about many steps that RBI has taken. We have talked about how they are trying to make the check system efficient, or how they are trying to come up with different modes of payment, be it NFC technology, near field communication, or be it contactless payments, right? So they are trying or developing UPI culture in India. So basically, our regulators are also trying to improve the infrastructure. Here you can see some more details. JP Morgan, one of the largest, is having largest GICs in India. Also, FMCG sector is going to set up their GICs in India. Considering the huge middle class sector or huge middle class chunk of population which is available here, growing middle class which is growing its demand for goods and services, right? Okay. So here is your third question. This third question says DASH refers to the actual act of investing in different categories of investment, whereas DASH is the process of balancing categories so that they offset one another amid ever changing market conditions, right? So correct option for this question is option B. Option B means asset allocation and diversification. So guys, there are two terms. First is called asset allocation. Other one is called diversification, right? So these are usually used interchangeably.
and you have to allocate your investment surplus or your investable surplus that you have. Just a second. Okay. So the investable surplus that you have to divide it among classes of assets. How much you want to invest in equity. Now how much you want to invest in bonds. They can be real estate. Right? They can be gold, they can be gold or they can be crypto assets. So basically, allocating your money in different among different assets. That is asset allocation. Now coming to diversification. Diversification is the process of balancing within these categories. Right? Now talking about equity, how much you want to invest into IT sector? How much you want to invest in auto, right? Or how much you want to invest in pharma? Same goes for bonds. If you want to invest into government bonds or corporate bonds, real estate, do you want to invest into direct? Do you want to invest into real estate directly or you want to invest into REITs, right? Gold, for gold also we have options of investing into digital gold or physical gold, right? So this first level is asset allocation, whereas the second level, when you have decided the classes of assets that you have invested into. See, for someone who is of some retirement age, let's say someone who is of age around 45, they might not want to invest into crypto, right? Because they are going to be skeptic of it, and obviously such type of assets like crypto assets, they have a regulatory gray area, and that is why there is risk associated with it, right? So they might not want to invest in it, but they might want to invest in gold or bonds. But for someone who is just beginning to invest, let's say some first time earner, someone who is aged around 25 years, this person might want to invest in crypto assets like Bitcoin or Ethereum or Tether, right? So this person who is young, has a huge risk appetite, is being driven by a risk. That is why has the capability to take on some risks. Whereas someone who is nearing retirement might not want to do it. So basically the first level is asset allocation, and after that, how you diversify or how you invest among these categories is the level of diversification, right? So I hope now this minor difference between asset allocation and diversification is clear. So deciding assets is asset allocation, and how you want to divide this within this particular category is diversification, right? So this might be possible that there is a particular portfolio which is not very much diversified, but assets are allocated very perfectly. Or it might be possible that asset allocation is not very good. Let's say a very young person not investing into risky assets, or an old person investing into risky assets, right? But they have diversified it very nicely to balance. See, the purpose of diversification is to balance, that if any loss happens in IT sector, it is balanced by the pharma sector, right? So basically to try to hedge the losses that one type of security can give you, right? So that is the difference between asset allocation and diversification. Okay. Diversification in investing reflects amount of same asset class holdings in your portfolio. How you are going to divide the same asset class, right? Asset allocation is the way in which assets are distributed in the portfolio along that align with your goals and objectives, right? Okay. Larger the number of holdings, the more diversified is your position, right? So see, if you are investing into equity, whether you want to invest into 5 stocks or you want to invest into 500 stocks, that is diversification. Choosing equity is asset allocation, and then deciding how much you want to divide this equity is diversification. So asset allocation, the way, okay, this allocation is based on age, risk tolerance, income needs, asset base and many other factors. Moving ahead to the next question. Question number 4, which says, following are some statements about antitrust laws. Select the ones which are not correct. So you have to select the incorrect statements here. Moving ahead to the correct option. Correct option for this question is option B. Option B means only 2. So only 2 is incorrect. Rest 1 and 3 are correct. Right? So 2 is incorrect. Now talking about antitrust laws, they are also called as competition laws. Why they are known as competition laws? Because the purpose of antitrust laws is to break the trust and allow free play of competition. Basically, in simple terms, these antitrust laws, they prevent the creation of monopoly. They want that the ultimate welfare should be of consumer in the market, and for that it is very important to have a free play of all the players in the market, and there should be no barriers. If there is only one company that is going to provide goods or services, then they might exploit the consumers by charging too high prices, and then they are not going to have any incentive to innovate, or they are not going to have any incentive to improve because there is no competition. They are the only leaders of the market, right? So let's say in one class there is only one student who is scoring above 90. Rest are scoring below 50. So since there is no competition, this student who is scoring 90 would never want to improve to 95 because he does not have any incentive. But let's say in a class where more than 50% of the students are securing 90% marks, then there is a rat race, or there is competition to secure more marks, and this might lead to improvement in the academic intellect of the students, right? So that is why competition is really necessary. So antitrust laws called as competition laws. So these laws have evolved along with the market vigilantly guarding the would-be monopolies. So this statement is not correct because they do not guard the monopolies, they guard against the would-be monopolies. That is why the statement is not correct. Antitrust laws prevent market allocation. Market allocation is nothing but it is like a regional monopoly. When one company decides that we are going to be working in this particular area. Let's say there are two rival companies. Let's talk about Maruti or Hyundai, right? Maruti and Hyundai, if they decide between themselves that Maruti is going to take the northern part of India, is going to operate in the northern part of India, and Hyundai is going to operate in the southern part of India. So basically, they have created a regional monopoly for themselves. So this is basically market allocation. So one purpose of these laws is to prevent market allocation because they want to increase the degree of competition in the market. Why are we studying about it? Because the creation of giants such as Facebook or Amazon, this is leading to regulators becoming more active because they want to check whether these companies, they are turning into monopolies or not. There are many cases against companies like Google or Facebook where it is alleged that they are abusing their dominant power in the market. Here you can see statutes developed to ensure fair competition. Right? Goal of these laws is to provide equal playing field for similar businesses. They stop businesses from playing dirty in order to make a profit. They don't want businesses to be indulged in any wrongdoings. They want healthy and fair competition in the market. So US government filed multiple antitrust cases against Google and Facebook in the last few months of 2020. In India also there were many cases filed. There was one case filed against WhatsApp. Right? So Competition Commission of India is also very active in trying to search that whether this competition is fair or not, right? Here you can see, so Facebook's acquisition of Instagram and WhatsApp, because they were being a threat to Facebook and Facebook then acquired them to earn from their profits. So US government is also investigating that. So Facebook says that why didn't you say something when we were acquiring the companies, now don't say anything, right? And Google, see, regulators are saying that people Google everything because they do not have any other option. Google is playing dirty so that it can be the only search engine in the market. But Google says that consumers do it because they want it to, right? Because they are having trust on this one company and they are liking the services of this one search engine. That is why they use it, right? So, see, at last, whatever is the decision has to be made by the regulators, has to be made by the judicial system of the country. But these are two sides that are being put by the regulators and the companies. Okay. So, this is the last question for today. This question says, there are three construction companies who are rivals in nature. All three of them trying to win a government contract to build a highway connecting two major states of the country. Cash Hairless, the CEO of these three companies, have had a secret meeting. They have decided to let one of the companies win this contract and the rest will win the others. That government is going to offer in future. What type of activity do you think these three companies are engaging into? Correct option for this question is option E, that is bid rigging. Basically, government is inviting bids that tell us who can build this highway most efficiently, and then we are going to award this contract to that particular company. But now you see that these companies are colluding with each other. They are trying to affect the degree of competition in market. How are they doing so? They, rather than being rivals or rather than being competitors, they are being friends. So this friendship is not good for the economy because we need them to be rivals. So cutthroat competition or engaging into dirty competition is not good. But this sort of friendship is also not good for the economy, right? So there has to be a healthy competition in order for everyone, for the industry, for the economy to grow. Now you can see what these three companies are doing. They are deciding that let one company win this contract and the other contracts that government is going to offer in future will allow you to win, right? So they are trying to keep everyone happy, and that is why they are not putting their true efforts. They are trying to make one company win, right? So this is not fair and this is known as bid rigging. They are trying to affect the bids which are being offered to the government. Okay, here you can see it is the illegal practice. Two or more parties collude to choose who will win a contract is called bid rigging. Making bids, the losing party will purposely make lower bids. So see, the losing party, the companies who are not going to win, or what is the incentive of these companies in not winning? They might be allowed to win the future contracts. So they deliberately, they make fake bids, or they make lower bids in order to allow the winner company to succeed in securing the deal, right? So that is the process that is called bid rigging. Can be further divided into following forms. First is bid suppression. Competitors refrain from bidding or withdraw a bid. Other competitors are going to withdraw from bid so that there is only one company to which contract is going to be offered, right? Complementary bidding, that means they make bids. They are not withdrawing from bids, but they are making a bid in such a manner that one company who is already decided that this person, so this you can understand it as a form of match fixing, that they have decided that who is going to be the winner, and they will play in a manner that they will make the pre-decided winner the actual winner, right? So this is something sort of this can be compared to the process of match fixing. So this is courtesy bidding. Competitors collude and make bids in a manner so that it seems like there is a healthy competition. Everyone is making bids, but actually there are no bids. Bid rotation, when one company is allowed to win one time and then they take turns being the lowest bidder on a variety of contract specifications, right? Such as contract sizes and volumes. Strict bid rotation patterns violate law of chance. So if there is a pattern that first one company is winning, then after two or three turns that company is again winning. So if there is a pattern that can be observed, then the regulators have to be active that there is something wrong going on and they have to stop it. right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then do not forget to hit the like button, and I'll be back in the next session with some new information. Till then, you guys keep watching, keep your studies going on, and thank you for being here.